Sorry if I made you jump there. Well, actually, I'm not. Because scares, and more specifically, jump scares, are exactly what I want to talk about today. The filmmaking technique, known colloquially as the jump scare, can come in a variety of different forms in a few different genres, but the foundation is almost always the same. Usually appearing in horror or thriller movies, a jump scare consists of something scary flashing onto screen, accompanied by some sort of scary noise designed to shock and terrify the viewer. Not dissimilar to what I did at the beginning of this video. Jump scares have been around nearly as long as horror cinema itself, and on the surface, it makes a lot of sense why. The jump scare presents itself as an easy way for the filmmaker to scare the audience in their seats. But it's this very simplicity that has given jump scares a pretty bad rap in the horror community. But not all jump scares are created equal. Let's consider a masterful implementation of this technique by filmmaker George Romero in his 1968 zombie horror masterpiece, Night of the Living Dead. For Romero, the scare doesn't start at the jump scare itself. Instead, it begins a few minutes earlier, with an argument breaking out between three of the people trapped inside the house that is slowly being surrounded by a horde of zombies.
Now I suggest we all go back downstairs before any of those things find out we're in here.
They can't get in here.
You got the whole place boarded up?
Yeah, most of it. All but a few spots upstairs. They won't be hard to fix.
You're insane. The cellar's the safest place.
I'm telling you, they can't get in here.
And I'm telling you, those things turned over our car. We were damn lucky to get away at all. Now you tell me those things can't get through this lousy pile of wood?
Even here, minutes before the jump scare itself, Romero is already paying close attention to the parallel between what the audience sees on the screen and the pictures that are being conjured in their mind's eye. The argument between these characters, people you aren't really fully familiar with, is causing you to internally question exactly what they're talking about. Can these boards really hold back a mob of the living dead?
You know how many's out there?
I don't know, maybe six or seven.
Look, you two can do whatever you like. I'm going back down to the cellar, and you better decide, because I'm going to board up that door, and I'm not going to unlock it again, no matter what happens.
Now, wait a minute, Mr. Cooper.
No, I'm not going to wait. I've made my decision, now you make yours.
Now, wait a minute. Let's think about this. We can make it to the cellar if we have to. And if we do decide to stay down there, we'll need some things from up here. So let's at least consider this a while.
If you box yourself in this cellar and those things get in the house, you've had it. At least up here you have a fighting chance.
As the voices, volume, and intensity of the argument are raised, the viewer can feel the steady buildup that Romero is creating and is on edge for when exactly it will crescendo. And how. Each character who approaches a window is a potential target, and every time you see them walk away unscathed is simply a step closer to the inevitable. These bait and switch almost scares, at a certain point, fall into a sort of rhythm. Each time you see a character check a window and walk back without being harmed, it's almost an oasis of calm and tranquility. As the character walks away, you know they're safe for now. And that lull is exactly what makes Romero's jump scare, when it finally does come, so effective.
There are a lot out back, too.
Instead of putting it after this oasis, when the audience has naturally come to expect it to happen, Romero puts it exactly in the middle, in a brief lull between moments of tension. But this technique isn't purely a filmic one. The precise, abrupt blast of motion and volume has its roots not in filmmaking, but in musical composition. In fact, we can hear it in one of the most famous pieces of music ever written. That That was Beethoven's Sonata No. 8 in C minor, as performed by Daniel Barenboim. While it may not have made you jump, it shares a quality in music composition with the core foundation of a jump scare, a technique in dynamics known as fortepiano. Fortepiano, a combination of the words forte, meaning loud, and piano, meaning soft, is the abrupt shift from a loud note to a soft one. It strikes up a sort of unease, a dissonance, and a feeling of falling forward. It's also the technique, in part, that gives Sonata No. 8 its other name, Pathétique. Despite what it may sound like, the name Pathétique has nothing to do with the state of being pathetic or sad. Instead, Pathétique is French for emotion. In this sense, fortepiano, while merely presenting itself in a few brief notes, is meant to convey worlds of emotion to the listener, or, in our case, the viewer, in the same way that Romero's jump scare, while lasting only a few seconds, can deliver fear, set up tension, and, in only a second or two, make you jump. Thanks for watching.